say some words and they never amount to anything. We never see the evidence of our prayers. And folks, we need a move of God upon our lives. You see, as we go down through what happened to Israel. Israel had went whoring after other gods. They had begun to worship idols, and they had begun to intermarry with those that God says, I want you to be separated from them, and I don't want you to be a part of them. And Israel went in and partook of their sins, got there and began to worship their gods and began to have idols. And folks, the churches did the same exactly thing today. Folks, we're doing the same thing that Israel did, and that's what's going to get us in trouble, is when we fail to come back to Him. You see, God said to Ezekiel, let's look at just a little bit what was going on. Israel had sinned. Nebuchadnezzar had sent his army and invaded Israel, Jerusalem. And in the first, he was carried away in three parts. You see what happens to the church. What has happened to the church today didn't happen all of a sudden. It's happened from all down through the ages. And we see that the church is beginning to fade and become powerless, and there's not no power within us anymore. Israel had lost his relationship with Jesus. He had lost his relationship with Almighty God. He had whored after other gods, material things, and all of these things. And God had turned him over, and he allowed Nebuchadnezzar to come in with his army and invade Jerusalem. And he carried off Daniel and his three friends. We know the story how Daniel was took into the king's palace and how he was used. But you see, in the first captivity of Jerusalem, we find that they took some of the key hostages away. And Daniel was one of them. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego was one of them. And when they got into Babylon, they would not bow to the other gods. They stood for God. They would not pray to the idols and worship the gods of Babylonians. And so God used Daniel, and Daniel was a great man of God. We need some Daniels today. We need some Daniels today to open the windows and stand out and be bold before God, regardless of what the world says. They're telling me today what I can preach and what I can't preach. And they're sharing with me what's going to happen in the future if I preach certain things. Daniel stood and threw the window open. And when it was time for him to worship, what happened? When it was time to worship the idols or the king's idols, Daniel stood up there boldly and would not worship. What happened to the three Hebrew children? Folks, I want you to know they wouldn't worship the God of Nebuchadnezzar. They were thrown into the furnace. And you know what happened? When they came and when they looked down into the furnace, they saw not three, but they saw four. And they knew that something had happened. As they were thrown into that furnace that was heated seven times hotter than ever before, and when the ones who threw them in knocked them back and it destroyed them, then something happened. They looked down in there, and they saw not three, but they saw four. And one, the Bible says, was as a son of man. Amen. Folks, do we live such a life that people looks at us, and when they see us, do they see Jesus in the midst of our lives? Do they see a power source within us? Do they see the power of God moving in our lives, and does it upset them? Or do they just see a normal person tonight? You see, the church hasn't got where she's at over 3 or 4 years. Can I just share something with you? When I was a teenager, when I was a youngster at church, y'all listen to me, moms and dads, I can remember when people were put out of the church because of dancing. Y'all can remember that? It's not anything in the world thought of it today. We teach our children dancing. We say that there's nothing wrong with dancing. But folks, let me tell you something. I've never seen anything good coming out of dancing unless you're dancing before the Lord to the glory of God. And folks, we can't preach on these things because if we do, we're going to get in trouble in the pulpit. Folks, let me tell you something. It's time that God wants a few men to stand up for Him.
Amen.
It's time that we stand up for Him. It's time that we let the people know where we stand for God.
Amen.
Israel had failed God. Israel had been carried away the second time when they had rebelled against God, when Jehoshaphat, and then when they had rebelled against God, Nebuchadnezzar sent his army in, and he took away 10,000 and took back to him with him. He made them submit. You may not believe it tonight, folks, but we as Americans today, we're submitting to the world today. We're submitting to all other religions. We're the only ones that doesn't have any rights tonight. We ought to stand up and we ought to be counted for God tonight.
Amen.
Everyone else can practice what they want to in school. Everybody else can do what they want to. They can have prayer and they can get down on their faces and they can bow and they can do all of their worship and they can do all of this. But you let a Christian mention the name of Jesus and I want you to know all hell breaks loose. Man, it's time today that we recognize where we are as a church. We have power in the name of Jesus. We don't have to allow these things. You mark my word, unless something happens, we're going to be overrun and overtaken by the Muslims. And if you're here and you're one of them, that's fine. You just need Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. And I have nothing against them, but I do have something against us being our Christianity and our walk with God being put aside.
Right.
You see, we didn't get here overnight. Down through the years from I've watched things as we have degraded ourselves. Now you see, the thing that happened is that Israel had sinned and they had got so far down till he had withdrew his protection from them. That umbrella of protection. When we walk out of the presence and the glory of God, I want you to know when we walk aside, the umbrella of protection from God is took down. And God will come against us and allow things to happen to us. We find that the third time. Over here in Babylon, here was Ezekiel. There was Daniel. There was the old prophet Jeremiah that was old. There was all these men of God. And there was these false prophets. There was these false preachers. And what they were teaching the people, they were saying to the people, they were saying, oh, everything's going to be okay. Jerusalem's not going to be destroyed. Just wait. Just don't pay any attention to what Ezekiel's saying. Don't pay any attention to what these false prophets, they were saying to the people and preaching to them. And they were telling them what they wanted to hear. And they were believing them instead of believing what Ezekiel was trying to tell them. That Jerusalem was going to be destroyed. And the false prophets were saying, they're not going to be destroyed. Everything's going to be okay. Folks, I want you to know what's happening today in the pulpit is the preachers is saying, everything's all right. It's okay for you to have your social drinks. It's okay for you to do your thing. It's all right, whatever you do, just so you come to church. He says, it's okay. But you see, the false prophets that was with the people, they were lying to them. We need a few good men of God that'll stand up today and tell the truth. Folks, we on a downhill slide. And folks, it's run away. And the only way it's going to be stopped is when we come together. And there becomes a shaking and a rattling. And when bone to bone comes together. And when the flesh becomes, when we become united and when we become powerful in Jesus. You see, the third time that Nebuchadnezzar made them submit, Jerusalem submit, he went in. And they set fire to Jerusalem and destroyed Jerusalem. And finally the message came. The message came to the people, and they were told, your city has been burned. But where was the messenger that had told them everything's all right? If we're comfortable tonight with the pastor's preaching, and we sit comfortable, and he's not bringing anything that's going to be problems to you, then something's wrong. When they brought the message that Jerusalem had been destroyed, they felt there's no hope. There's no hope. But Ezekiel said, there is hope. God will take you back home. You see, as we look at that, we find that as they were as low as they could get. Folks, when the church gets to the point that she is burdened down, and I believe that's where we're headed right now. The only hope for America today is a few church people that pray and seek God. We're still standing today by the grace of God. And unless that we stand firm and strong, we too are going to be destroyed. Let me tell you something, folks. You listen to me. While we send our little messengers to Washington, we need to realize what we're sending up there. We need to make sure that when they get there, what they're going to do, and they're going to stand up for the people. Stand up for God. Amen. As Christians. Right. Folks, when we go and when we vote down at the booth, we need to know that who we're voting for is going to stand for God. Amen. You see, the church hasn't got where she's at today in the past year. Down through the years, we have allowed things to creep into the church. And folks, we look so much like the world today till the world can't tell the difference in us. Ezekiel, in chapter 37, he told about the valley of dry bones. He said that the Lord was up on me and carried me away. And folks, we may think that it was just a carrying away, just maybe in thought. But I believe that the Lord literally picked him up in the spirit and took him into Jerusalem and set him down out in the valley. And he said, now I want you to walk around and I want you to look at all the dry bones. Folks, when I go through this nation, when I go through this world, when I go from church to church, when